So these were steroids, and he was the first one to demonstrate the chemical structure of these, that they really have these ring systems, which on the one hand looked like even more complex, but then through really a very brilliant, perhaps accidental discovery, but brilliant one, he discovered in essentially two extremely simple steps. You can convert all this molecular garbage into this side chain, which meant that this became suddenly, and a very high yield, became a fantastic raw material for the synthesis of progesterone. And he quit Penn State and went to Mexico and collected some and made a couple of kilos of progesterone. Now that was probably the world supply, which he just made in a relatively short while, and then convinced a couple of, again, European refugees, one from Germany, one from Hungary, who had a small Mexican pharmaceutical lab, to form Syntex, a small company to manufacture progesterone from Diosgenin. And they did this. And again, in his usual story, as I told you, he broke it off. He broke off relation within a year and walked away with the, you might say, the know-how. So there these people had a little company that was manufacturing progesterone. To give you an idea, this cost at that time around $80 a gram, and $80 in the early 1940s was an awful lot of money. I mean, that would be probably several thousand dollars in today's money per gram. So that was a lot of money. They identified George Rosenkranz in Havana as a steroid chemist and persuaded him to come to Mexico. Of course, he already was in Latin America, already spoke Spanish and so on here. And he basically redeveloped that process. I mean, it was not a secret process because Mark had published it in the scientific literature, but it's one thing to publish something on a gram scale and something else to do it industrially, and they had no idea of doing it. And you might say George Rosenkranz had to rediscover it, not in a fundamental way, but in a practical way. And he did it very quickly. And then so they resumed manufacture of progesterone. And then he worked out a way of also making testosterone from it. So Syntex at that time within, that was formed in 44, 45, by 1948, 49, was already manufacturer of progesterone and testosterone, although no one had ever heard of Syntex, because of course they were not a pharmaceutical company. They formed it and sold it to other pharmaceutical companies. But that was already very unusual because you had here a company in an absolute third world country, because scientifically Mexico, you could say, didn't exist on the scientific front. There was not a single Mexican PhD in chemistry yet who had gotten his PhD there. There were a few who had gotten it abroad. And so that was a very small company, annual sales of maybe $2 or $3 million. But and then cortisone, of course, hit the news, and they decided to see whether they could make cortisone from Diosgenin, their raw material. So you realize what it involved was to try and work out a way, this degradation of the side chain to this side chain, one already knew from Marcus days. The transformation, so then one had to learn how to transform this into this after going from here to here. But most importantly still, what do you do about this oxygen? How do you get that in there? And that was a fascinating chemical problem, fascinating, because you just couldn't do it just at that time, de novo. And what really worked out is a way of gradually moving it, moving around the periphery until finally you labelize this position and add oxygen, many different chemical steps. So everyone's grandmother was working on this, as I said. I'm using this, belaboring that point, everyone's grandmother. There were no grandmothers in this. They actually were mostly young, testosterone-driven chemists. Most of them below the age of 40. And that was an international race.